Hi, my name is Rich McHugh, and I'm going to be your instructor for EDCI 337, Interactive and Multimedia Learning. I'm going to be using a lecture style for this first topic, along with a few pictures and text for illustration and emphasis. But first, let me tell you why learning to create effective multimedia and online learning objects or presentations is so important. Two of the skills that we hopefully all learn while at university, no matter what faculty we're in, is to be able to think critically and write persuasively. Another skill that complements and builds on critical thinking and persuasive writing is the ability to make compelling and memorable multimedia presentations or multimedia objects. So here's a personal example for you. I've written several academic papers on flipped learning and makerspaces, but if I'm honest, I suspect that very few people, other than academics in my discipline, have taken the time to read my research papers. So does that mean that I shouldn't be doing research and writing academic papers? No, but what I should probably do in addition to writing research papers is also make short videos or create infographics that highlight in an accessible way the key findings of my research, not only for other researchers, but other educators who could apply my work in their classrooms or makerspaces. For example, a one-minute video or well-designed infographic could be easily shared on Instagram, TikTok, or Facebook, and could more effectively communicate to a broader audience how makerspaces and flipped learning can help children have more engaging, interesting, and educational experiences in their schools and classrooms. Using multimedia learning principles can also be helpful in universities and businesses to create more effective presentations and avoid the dreaded death by PowerPoint presentations that we've all experienced and been subjected to. One of my children took a course in Python programming at a university this past year, and just to be clear, that was not at the University of Victoria. But she did it in an online course much like this one, except that in the course she took, she only read a textbook and completed assignments that were given to her. When she arrived home last summer, I asked her if she'd like to work with me on a web application project that's for the Digital Scholarship Commons in the library where I work, to make it possible for people on campus to submit 3D print jobs remotely and then pay for them with a credit card or debit card. I found some online resources to help teach her the basics of a different programming language than the one she'd learned at school. But one big difference between her class at this other university and the programming language that she was learning during the summer was that because we sat beside each other at home, she could get immediate feedback on what she was learning, much like an apprenticeship. And if I wasn't available, she could get feedback from her brother, who's a software engineer in Calgary, via Slack or via Zoom. This combination of digital learning objects that she could access in a just-in-time fashion when she needed them, and mentors who could give her immediate feedback, made her learning experience much more interactive and efficient. Another positive aspect of the learning experience was that she was working on a project that would be used and appreciated by a lot of people on campus, rather than just another throwaway assignment that only she and her professor would see. Before I go any further, let's define a couple of terms that are important to this topic, as well as the whole course. The first one is synchronous, which means real time. In terms of education, that would mean a real-time class, whether that be in a video like Zoom or in a face-to-face class in a classroom. Another term is asynchronous, which means that you go at your own pace through the course materials. The topic that you're working through today would be an example of an asynchronous class or coursework. Robert Mayer, a multimedia learning expert, identified John Amos Comius's book, Orbis Pictus, as one of the first multimedia learning objects ever created. Multimedia means more than one medium combined together to convey information. The first successful development of a multimedia technology was an instructional book for children entitled Orbis Pictus, or The World in Pictures in English. Each page showed a drawing of a scene like a bird, along with a printed name for each drawing and corresponding to a number. The multimedia book was published in 1658 by John Comenius, and for more than a century it was the most popular textbook in Europe. Why was the world's first multimedia textbook so successful? Well, the answer lies in Comenius's learner-centered approach, based on the idea that words and things must go together. In spite of the advances in technology that we see today, the success of high-tech multimedia learning objects still depend on designing them in ways that are in sync with how people learn. Today, when we think of multimedia, we usually think of digital things like video, PowerPoint, apps for our phones and tablets. Learning outcomes can be improved by the effective use of multimedia, but not just the use of any multimedia. Multimedia has to be structured using best practices and following the principles of multimedia learning in order to be effective. Digital learning techniques allow us to distribute multimedia learning objects for asynchronous learners, and this makes learning much more accessible. We don't need to package up and mail a textbook or a DVD to people, as the web makes learning objects, including video, accessible. Online distribution not only makes these learning objects more accessible, but it also differentiates or helps personalize the learning. With a digital learning object, learners can slow it down, speed it up, or review the multimedia as many times as they like or as many times as they need. That said, multimedia and interactive learning isn't new. As we just saw, it goes back at least to Orbis Pictus in 1658. The last thing I'm going to talk about today is narrative and story. Narratives can add life to multimedia learning objects. Not adding a narrative to a multimedia object would be like learning how to film or edit a movie without learning how to write a script for it. Done well, people can learn even without knowing that they're learning. A great example of narratives and how they can help us learn without knowing is a story about one of my sons from a few years ago. I came home from work one day after taking a workshop on game mechanics and serious games. As I entered my house, I noticed that my son was playing a web-based game called Pandemic. After watching him play for a little bit, I did some research and discovered that the game mechanics of Pandemic were very close to how disease and viruses spread in real life. So, while he played this game, he was actually learning a lot about viruses, disease, and how vaccinations can help prevent the spread of disease. His learning was effortless because he was fully engaged and having fun. So in conclusion, multimedia learning isn't new, but it's so important in education in particular, because multimedia learning can improve learning outcomes if they're done right. The digital versions of multimedia learning objects, combined with the internet, can make multimedia much more accessible as well as allow people to go at their own pace. We need to always remember, however, that not all multimedia learning objects are created equal, and we need to make sure that we follow best practices and multimedia learning principles as we create our own learning objects and as we choose multimedia learning objects available to us.